just know that you can't be perfect at everything. Somebody's always going to tell you, oh, you didn't do so well at work. I did the best I could. You were not the greatest mom. I did the best I could. You were not the greatest wife. I did the best I could.
Indra Nooyi, thank you very much for joining us here at She the People. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. I read your book. I mean, I've also followed your journey for a long time. Why did you want to write this book? What's your big piece with it?
You know, when I left PepsiCo, there was a lot of talk about why weren't you replaced by a woman? Why didn't you replace yourself with a woman as a CEO? It's surprising because they asked women CEOs that, they never asked the men CEOs about it. Even though women CEOs are such a small percentage of the total number of CEOs. Along with that question, they kept asking me, how did you do it? How did you stay married and have two kids and become CEO? There must have been some manual or something that you have that you should share with us, because we'd all like to do the same thing too. As I sat back and thought about it, I started to dig into why aren't there more women bubbling up to the top to become CEOs? And I realized that they come into the workforce in large numbers. By the time they reach middle management, the numbers have dwindled and the pipeline is just broken. And as you dig in more deeply into this issue, you realize that any woman who also wants to have a family faces the motherhood penalty, where they just cannot balance it all. There are no support systems that exist for people to balance being a, you know, family builder and engaging in productive work outside the home and earning a paycheck. And then on top of that, they face all kinds of biases inside the company that, you know, really causes an enormous stress. So I set out to write some policy papers on what can be done to address this issue. And those around me, people who truly cared about what I was doing, said, all these policy papers are great, Indra, but, you know, the shelf life of these is like a week. People read it and throw it away. On the other hand, if you were to inform what you were saying with the arc of your life, stories of your life, and laid it out not as a memoir in a tell-all basis, but your journey and why you're saying what you're saying about supporting women, supporting young family builders, the manual, if you want to call it that, translated into your life, would be so much better and engaging for people to read. And publishers came my way and said, people really want to read about it. So what started reluctantly as a book, now I've gotten a lot of enthusiasm and energy around it, because my writer did a great job working with me to translate all of these thoughts into a readable book.
You know, it obviously takes you back in time, but it reminds the reader that there is so much of growth for any person over many years of working in an organization and navigating that journey. When you look back, what would you say were some of the most difficult moments that you had to navigate your way to the top?
I came into the workforce when there weren't any women in the workforce. Women were just beginning to emerge in professional schools. In the business schools, for example, women were capped by the number of rooms available in the women's floor, which was 12 in IIM Calcutta. And so it was very early in the year, in the evolution of women in business. So everything we were doing was frame-breaking. Men didn't know how to cope with women in the workforce. Women didn't know what their position was in the workforce. When you think of a sales training program, or, you know, all of us went through management training, should we be doing the same thing that men are doing? Should we be carrying our sales bag and going into villages alone? You know, all these rules had to be rethought. Societal norms had to be rethought. And at every point in time, it was like peeling back an onion. One more layer of the onion was being unveiled to us. And so it was quite a process of discovery, Shaili.
So what did you dream of when you were getting out of college and getting into your first job? And the reason I ask you that is that there is a feeling among women that they would rather benchmark themselves and their aspirations slightly lower because they seem achievable, and not that high because it seems a little distant. How did you navigate that?
That again is true in some ways and perhaps not true in others. And let me speak to where it is true. I didn't have any role model women to benchmark myself against. So my point is, I'm just going to keep doing what I know to do well. And then let's see where this journey takes me. At that point, a woman being CEO was unheard of. There were no role models whatsoever in industry. As a politician, yes, because there was Mrs. Gandhi, Mrs. Pandit. So as a politician, you could aspire to be something, but that was inherited jobs in many cases. So you sit there going, oh, we're not a political family. Maybe you can be a judge. Maybe you can be a doctor. You know, these are all professional degrees, but not in the corporate world. We had no idea what the corporate world was about. And nobody from our family really was in the corporate world. So we didn't have an aspiration to be in the corporate world. So you just aspire to be the best you can at whatever you're doing. Had we had women role models, we could have looked up to them and said, wow, you know, I too can be that person. But I do have a piece of advice for all your viewers, Shaili, or all your listeners. If you start off saying, I want to be CEO and get obsessed about that, you are so worried about progression to be CEO, you forget the job on hand. You can say, okay, I want to be CEO, break it down into bite-sized chunks. I want to do this job very well. And if I can somehow progress the next two jobs in the next 5 years, that would be progress. Very many people sit down and say, you know, I think I have what it takes to be CEO. And I'm going to go for it. I don't know what that means. I have no idea what that means. Remember, it's a pyramid. It narrows so much as you start moving up to the top. So survive the first three levels and be known for something and be damn good at what you do. You'd be surprised after that how many doors open for you. That's where we all make the mistake.
I'm curious to know how your mom's approach changed over the, you know, decade of you being there in the top and talk about these issues more openly with you. The role that a woman has to play because she's at home as a mom, as a wife and so on.
So we said, look, you're CEO, that's a big job and I appreciate it, but nobody else can be the mom or the wife. So you're going to have to juggle the two. We will all help you. But if you're not there to help you, it's still your responsibility. And now with two daughters, it's definitely your responsibility. And so the one good thing is I married the right person. And he looked at this as a true partnership. And that makes a huge difference, because if you have a spouse who does not believe this is an equal, sometimes unequal, where he has to carry more of the load. And other times, you know, I carry more of the load. If we don't agree that we're going to have to work together very, very meticulously to plan our life, both at work and at home, this is not going to work, because we're all juggling three or four full-time jobs. And so even when I was announced to be CEO, my mother's first reaction was, well, let me call Steve and ask him to stay on because you have too much to do at home. I go, Mom, that's not how it works. I said, look, I am going to be announced as CEO. Just talk to me about how we're all going to make it work. But she was not wrong in what she said. I think deep down inside, she was proud, although she'll never say it. Deep down inside, she was proud. And she would have helped any time I wanted the help. And I think that's another important lesson for people. From the time you graduate from college, build your support system. Know who's going to support you, your friends, your family. Build that support system. How are your parents, multi-generational living, going to work? Because unless you're in a country which has a spectacular childcare system, it's not possible to make it work.
So I just followed you on Instagram and I saw that you were chatting with a lot of young girls. I really, one of the questions I always ask women leaders, and it's one of my favorite questions, is that how important is financial freedom for women, and why that conversation needs to happen at a more wider scale among women? Because there is this perception, oh, when women are chatting, they're talking about shoes and bags, and financial freedom is not even a priority. So first, why do you think, as a successful woman, it's very important to have it?
You know, I make that point in chapter one of my book. Up front, we deal with it. Families are wonderful, but families are messy. Families are fragile. You never know when the family structure breaks up or there's an unexpected event in the family structure which results in the primary, wage earner unable to bring in the bucks, or just disappears from the scene for whatever reason. What happens to the family then? What's the woman supposed to do? In many cases, the in-laws are not taking the responsibility because once the guy is not in the picture, they just cast the daughter-in-law out of the picture. What happens then? If there are kids, who's going to support them? So I think we have to think about not going to school at that point to earn a paycheck, because that's another five-year process. It ain't going to work. You've got to be prepared for any situation. So it's very important that women have the power of the purse, have the ability to go out and get a job to ensure family stability.
Okay, I'm going to switch gears, come back to the core of the book in terms of, the saying, women can't have it all. While writing the book, and of course, as a reader, while reading it, I mean, I just feel like Indra Nooyi had it all, right? So I'm just thinking, where are you on that piece? And does it always look like that to others, that it's also well put together? But you might have struggled with this, can I have it all, a big deal?
Indra had it all with so much difficulty. But she didn't really have it all because I didn't spend all the time with my kids that I could have, I wanted to. I didn't spend enough time with my mom as much as I would have liked to, okay? So it's a question of juggling all of these, right? You can never spend all the time with the kids that you want to or would like to. You can't do enough justice to the job. At every point you're making trade-offs. So we never took too many vacations because there was always work and home calling. We never went to too many shows or entertainment because it was always tough to do at home. So I think everything is about what are you willing to give up to get something? That's what we did at every point in time. We gave up time with each other. We gave up time with the kids. We made it up in other ways, but at every point it was a little trade-off here, a little balance here, a little tweaking here to the schedule. Something that could be done in person, doing it in via telephone. I don't think there's a formula for having it all. And I don't even know what having it all is. Just know that you can't be perfect at everything. You just can't. Yeah. And we all have the perfection gene. You can't be perfect at everything. Somebody's always going to tell you, oh, you didn't do so well at work. I did the best I could. You were not the greatest mom. I did the best I could. You were not the greatest wife. I did the best I could. That's the juggling act.
So one of the big debates around the world is the potential of measuring housework. What are your views on that? Putting value to it.
I know, I've been reading the debate about paid housework. Slippery slope, because even though the laws might exist that you have to pay people for housework, in reality you pay them and then you expect them to pay for the household expenses. And to me, that's what I'm worried about. Because if you pay them and then they say, I can save it for my own self, that's one thing. But as long as they're not earning the money independently, it's coming from somebody else who's earning, my fear is that the money that's given to the woman for housework in a marriage or in a family can be appropriated anytime the family needs it without the woman even having permission. In fact, I hear about many families where they work outside the home and they still have to give access to their entire paycheck to even the in-laws. Yeah. I think all of that has to be rethought. Now, again, I'm not the one to upset society. That's not what I'm trying to do. I'm not trying to upset families. But I think we have to stop and ask ourselves, when we give birth to a girl child, don't we want this girl child to be an equal person? Did we give birth to somebody to say she's going to be unpaid labor for the rest of her life? I don't think so. Let's live in that spirit. And as in-laws, especially mothers-in-law, support the daughter-in-law, support the daughters. Don't view this as, I suffer, therefore they must suffer. Don't. Sometime the chain has to be broken.
Five questions you were asked, but men are not.
questions asked or comments made. First, yeah. They always ask is, how do you balance work and life? I get asked that question all the time. The other question I keep getting asked is, How do you and husband keep your marriage going? Do you have date nights? How do you make time for that? No silly concepts, but you know what? I see the value of them, but in our life, every day was a date night because anytime I saw my husband, we were together. But I understand what they mean about keeping the excitement going in your marriage. That's a question I keep getting asked. You know, my mother would ask me, my in-laws would ask me, are you focusing enough on the elder people too? Absolutely, yes. Spending enough time with your daughters. Are you sure that you're there as a mom? I would be asked at work about how do you handle all the bias that women face? And I'm always forced to think about it, respond as to how I handled it, because people want to know how I took on traditional male practices and still made it in the female world, as a female in the workforce. And then I keep getting asked, what have you done to promote them? What have you done to promote people who are diverse? So these are pretty standard questions, but people probe and push and test to see my resolve, test to see my convictions. I go through that all the time. Even today, even though I'm not a full-time business executive, people ask me this question even today.
And the final question is, what would your advice be to young women who are wondering how they should take on their career or let's say entrepreneurship?
I'd say the next few decades are the decades of women, because the economy needs smart people and a lot of the women are the smart people. So the decades of the women. If you choose to have a family and engage in paid work outside the house, know that you have to build a support structure. And also know that having a family can be very fulfilling too. So it's not all stress. Can, you know, when you have kids, it's just a very fulfilling thing, at least for me. And so build a support structure, because without the support structure, you will be running ragged. Yeah. Then the work, also the job outside the home is not going to be fun anymore. And I'd say to them, finally, make sure you have some economic freedom, some financial freedom. Please make sure you understand finances. Make sure that you become financially literate.